These topics that
is the central core of the meeting, of the conference, the summit, I try to address in a specific way, just to remember the concept of gender medicine. We follow this concept and we work on this field in the last year in the context of an European project involving responsible research and innovation, RRI. And we try to see how in this date, in our infection, in mainly women infection, how we can see if the gender has been considered. In the last year, we focused mainly in experimental animals without any attention, mainly if it's female or male, and also in the human being. And when we called about gender medicine, there are biological differences and culture norm which affect our way of to do research and clinical trials and therapies. For example, the effect of the sexual hormones on the immune system, that has been also quoted in the previous presentation, is very, very, very relevant. And we have not this information. We have a lot of spare information, diffuse information, I want to say superficial information, at a different level of the innate and adaptive immunity, at the level of different cells, at the level of different markers, a different, but we cannot take the whole picture. So we are going in the detail, but we lose the whole picture. And this is a real problem, as in the next slides we can see. To know the activation of the immune system is very important in infection. And we have to consider that steroids, sexual hormones, modify, interfere, can depress the immune system physiologically and then in pathological situation. Okay, this is just one example for one specific sexual hormones, which is very relevant. Just also to say again that there is a lot of data about all different cells, different subset of cells, but still we have not catched the whole picture. Also the age, we say female, but females are not always the same. There are young female, there are old female, there are menstrual moment, there is a pregnancy. So the age and the physiological condition may be different. We have to take in account. You have to take in account, and the key message that I will leave at the end, that we are not doing this. We are not doing this. And the information, the epidemiological information, is that there is difference in immune activation. For example, in autoreactive immunity, in which the immune system develops activation against the cell component. And we have a strong evidence that women differs from male in these aspects. If you just see that, oh, sorry. If you just see, no, I want to go back. Okay, just see the difference, the ratio between female and male. So it's impressive in some disease. And if you consider, yesterday we learned very well from several presentations, the importance of some infection, mainly sexually transmitted infection in women. So this information gives us some way to think about that we cannot treat in the same way. Okay, I don't want to go to this, just I would like to that you take in this number. 76 of young people are female in HIV. And now that finally after 25 years, the WHO guideline give the compulsory to start the treatment with antiretroviral therapy immediately after infection. Very simple concept, we take 25 years to accept it. We are treating male and female, men and women in the same way. So we are not taking account of the key message that we are in situation in which the immune system may be different between women and male. And when we do an antiretroviral treatment, we know that we are changing the state of activation of these cells. And also the role of sex hormones at a specific mucosal level, because it's much easier to look at the level, general level, in the blood level. But if we go at the specific level, we can imagine how important is the balance of the immune system in a physiological situation, for example, in pregnancy, when there is an F1 hybrid fetus, and the immune system in some way have to be decreased to avoid rejection. And in this situation, we can have a potential increase of infection because the immune system is in some way physiologically depressed by always the presence of an equilibrium of different hormones. So just take another example about tuberculosis in women. We have the strong evidence that notification is much double in men than in women. So this is a gender problem. It's not a sexual problem, it's a gender. So why women are less notified to be infected by tuberculosis? And if it's notified, they are not present in the normal health system which fight against tuberculosis. Then there are a lot of other biological information that we need to fight in the right way against tuberculosis in women. Just give some number, mainly take the attention to Africa region. So we have a lot of tuberculosis in women, both with either with HIV or not with HIV, but we have tuberculosis in women. And if we consider, for example, the different age of women with tuberculosis, we can see that in the young age, in the reproductive age, we have much more rapid progression of tuberculosis than in the elder age of women. So also the age in the specific sex differ. And we don't take in account this in the treatment. We treat always in the same moment, in the same, with the same drug, with the same dosage regime, without any taking account any gender consideration. Nutrition. Nutrition also is important. It's not true that we need the same amounts of microelement, we need the same amounts of vitamin, we need the same amounts. It's different in women and men. And we can see why this nutrition and metabolism is associated to tuberculosis. And we don't take the difference between male. So some of the features are influenced again by sex steroids and aging, and play a part of differential progression disease, mainly in airborne tuberculosis. So the simple question, did scientists investigate in deep the relation between sex hormones and mycobacterial infection? No. So this is a very important field of research that we can ask the young generation of African scientists to take in their hands. If we go now in practical things, clinical trials and therapy, can we consider in the right way the gender? I'd say that just now maybe, but in the past we didn't. And this is the evidence that this bias in drug efficacy, the side effect, bring to the threat of the elimination of the market of several drugs. So it's very important that for many of these differences, maybe genetic, maybe hormonal, maybe anatomy, we have to consider. We cannot release in the market drugs which has been in the same way analyzed for male and for women. Okay, that's just to make some evidence about the pharmacokinetics importance in the gender. Bioavailability, distribution, metabolism, extraction, there are so many patterns that we need to analyze. And of course, if we don't make any difference, we can have different adverse effect. So now I go to my field, my specific field, and why we leave this key message. Now we know that everybody knows that AIDS was considered an immunological syndrome at the beginning. After a few years, we realized that it was an infectious disease. We take 25 years to apply the concept that if you have a replicating agent, you have to start immediately with anti-replicating drugs. We do this normally with antibiotics and bacteria, but we haven't did with viral HIV. So it means that we have some gap in this. And now, fortunately, thanks to this changing in the guidelines in Africa, we can start immediately HIV treatment, immediately in children, immediately in men, immediately in female. But what we are doing? We are treating all people with the same dosage, the same medical drugs, without any consideration of gender diversity. Is this correct? I think not. I show you why. We have strong evidence now in Africa that if we start on good treatment, 90% of people collapse in the viremia. So we are very able to show that treated people with good drugs, after 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, they have no more viral load in the blood. So we are very happy because we have viral replication, we give a therapy, we block the viral replication. But all people treated with low viremia or no viremia at all are completely in the same state? No. We show, for example, there is some group of people which have very strong immune activation. Although there is no virus, in the blood, in the tissue, T cells, macrophages are activated. So what happens? That if we go further in the analysis, we can see that many individuals with the same noviremia, with the same, in some way, state of activation, they can have different metabolic disease, different metabolic markers of activation. This is normally what happens when you have CD40 cells in the steady state, not activated, and what happens when the T cells are activated with a metabolic activation. For example, GLUT1 protein is a very good marker of activation in terms not in immunity, but in terms of metabolic disorder. And we have to follow this. And men and women differ in metabolism, differ very, very strongly. And we know now that after activation of T cells, although there is no virus, T cells continue to be activating and go in a metabolic exhausting situation. If you do the same, activating macrophages go to foam cells, which are responsible for atherosclerosis. So it means that viral infection, immune disorder, can bring to metabolic disorder. So now we are in this area of the AIDS, especially doctors that have to treat it. They cannot just think, oh, CD40 cells are good, there is no viremia, so we are happy. No, we are not happy, because at the same moment in which there is no viremia, in which there is no decrease of CD40 cells, we are in situation developing a metabolic disorder. And there is a very big difference in age and sex. And we have to take in account the treatment. We are not doing. We are not doing. We give the same dosage for a man and for a woman. We don't take in account of the weight, the sex, the situation of hormones. Always the same pills. So this is the key message, that although we are able now to treat people for HIV, we are not taking account the whole organism. We are just going for one specific aspect, maybe the number of CD40 cells, maybe the viral load in the blood, but we are not taking account the whole picture. So the residual immune cell activation that is always present also fails the so-called non-AIDS or metabolic morbidities, atherothrombosis, osteoporosis, metabolic syndrome, and so on. So this comorbidity will be our problem in the future, when now in Africa we are starting to diffuse the therapy. So this is our, now at the moment, our field of activity and the key message that sex and gender consideration needs to be taken in great accounts for therapy in HIV/AIDS. Thank you for your attention.